Good morning and welcome to the 2017 Finance Professional Show. My name is Karen Schroeder. I run a company called MediaNet, a key partner of the show today. I'm delighted to be running the very exciting all-day multi-format conference program, which is in association with our newest online title, Specialist Banking. Whilst I would love to talk more about the show and what a labor of love it has been, the caliber of our outstanding lineup, and also how proud we are of the content of our sessions, our keynote speaker is a particularly good one, and I don't want to steal too much of his time. So Christopher May is an important source of knowledge at this significant time in our and the world's political history. Having served 37 years as a British diplomat, Christopher has fulfilled roles which provide unrivaled insights into the relationships that exist between nations. He was ambassador to the US for 5.5 years, and to Germany, with postings to the former Soviet Union, Spain, and the European Union in Brussels. He was also a press secretary to Prime Minister Sir John Major, press secretary to Foreign Secretary the late Lord Howe, and speechwriter to 3 foreign secretaries. An author, documentarian, and regular in the media, Christopher has kept busy since retiring from the diplomatic service in 2003. He is a non-executive director of the Arbuthnot Banking Group and chairman of the advisory board of Pagefield, a public relations company. The UK's relationship to the US, what next to expect from its mercurial leader, and the possible future that awaits us after our emancipation from the EU, Christopher has an opinion on it all. I encourage you to take it in and to probe further during our Q&A session. So, without further preamble, please join me in welcoming Sir Christopher May.
Thank you very much, Karen. That will, I think, do as the first draft for my obituary. So if I can take it away with me when I leave. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here at Olympia, the Finance Professional Show. Actually, your organisers asked me to take you to the cutting edge of international geopolitics in the second decade of the 21st century. So I thought the natural place to begin was in the year of our Lord, 1604. As historians among you will remember, this was a year after King James I had come to the throne after the death of Queen Elizabeth I. What has this got to do with contemporary geopolitics? Not a lot, but bear with me, and I will get to the point. James decided that year to appoint a distinguished diplomat, spy, and man of letters, Sir Henry Wotton, to the plum diplomatic posting as ambassador to the Republic of Venice, then a great Mediterranean superpower. As Sir Henry made his way through Germany, on the way to take up his position, he stopped with an English friend in the German city of Augsburg. And the following morning, he wrote in his host's guest book a phrase that has ever since echoed down the halls of diplomacy. An ambassador is an honest man sent to lie abroad for the good of his country. And what I wanted to emphasize to you, ladies and gentlemen, is that I thoroughly enjoyed lying abroad for the good of the United Kingdom, first of all in the Federal Republic of Germany, and then in the good old USA. And in Germany, I was able rapidly to confirm the wisdom of the great American writer Mark Twain's saying that a German joke is no laughing matter. And that was in 1997. I hope no Germans here. That was in 1997, when Germany had just decided to adopt the euro. And I went to see the Deputy Finance Minister and say, I'm going to find out about this. When was this going to happen? Was he happy with the idea? And we in London at the time were wondering whether we too should give up the pound and join the euro. And this chap, who's actually quite a good friend of mine, he said to me, well, I do hope the United Kingdom is going to join us in the euro, because for God's sake, don't leave us alone with the French. Then, it's a true story. This is a true story. A couple of months later, I found myself in Paris at the invitation of an ambassador there. And he took me along to the French Foreign Ministry to see the Secretary General, kind of senior non-political appointee there, like our permanent undersecretary. So we went to see the Secretary General, we had a conversation about this and that, and we started talking about the euro. And France also had decided, like Germany, that it was going to support the introduction of the euro 2 years later. And this chap said to me, he said, are you going to join? And I said, well, we're thinking about it. And he said, well, I really do hope that you do, because we don't want to be left alone in the Eurozone with the Germans. So there you go. Diplomacy is not quite it seems. It's often a matter of shadow boxing and shadow games. It was an even greater pleasure to lie abroad for the good of the United Kingdom in the United States of America. Before I left Washington to take up my job, I was summoned to Downing Street to get my marching orders from the Prime Minister, Tony Blair, of blessed memory. And I was ushered into one of the grand reception rooms on the first floor and asked to wait. So I was sitting there and suddenly the door opened and his chief of staff, Jonathan Powell, burst into the room saying, I'm awfully sorry, but Tony's got held up. But basically what he wants you to do is to get up the arse of the White House and stay there. Now, that crisp instruction was actually all that I needed. You see, my most important goal as ambassador was to get to know the President of the United States, at the time Bill Clinton, and his senior staff, so that I could persuade them to do the things that the United Kingdom wanted them to do, and to dissuade them from doing the kind of things that we didn't want them to do, which usually involves some issue of trade, unpleasant tariffs, quotas, anti-dumping measures, banana wars, chicken wars, and so forth. Anyway, after a few months, 1998, I felt that I had carried out Blair's instructions and got to know Bill Clinton pretty well. Now, some of you may have seen a movie which came out in the 90s called Primary Colors. It's a political film starring John Travolta and Emma Thompson. Amazing couple, if you think about it. John Travolta and Emma Thompson, who played an ambitious political married couple who were seeking the presidency of the United States. And being Hollywood, they were obviously seeking the Democratic presidency. And at the beginning of the film, there is a sequence right at the beginning demonstrating political handshakes and the hierarchy of political intimacy that these handshakes demonstrated. So there was the ordinary handshake, hand to hand, you know, the kind of thing you do every day. That was the base political handshake. And then the next notch up in political intimacy was the handshake with the other hand seizing the elbow. You know? Shake the hand, seize the elbow, and both of you can do it at the same time, although it can be physically quite complex. And then, the very height of the political handshake was the hand, as ever, the base movement, and the vigorous rubbing of the upper shoulder. The upper arm, sorry, upper arm, not shoulder, the arm. So you would go, and you'd do that. That the two of you cannot do simultaneously, it's impossible. I know, I've tried it. Anyway, I ran into Bill Clinton sometime in the spring of 98 at some reception, and he gave me the upper arm rub. And I thought, yeah, you know, I'm there in political intimacy. He knows me, and he recognizes me, and he's giving me the ultimate accolade. And I thought, I am truly up the arse of the White House now. I knew a guy in Washington who's a young staffer in the White House called Rahm Emanuel, who is now the mayor of Chicago. They rise fast in the US. I knew him quite well. He'd come over to the embassy, we'd have lunch, just the two of us, and he'd give me a bit of gossip about what was going on in the White House. He had a brilliant sense of humor, and although it was very, very sort of sardonic and cynical, and this was just after Monica Lewinsky, I hasten to add, after she had exploded or imploded, depending on the point of view. And I said to Rahm, hey, I've had the ultimate accolade. The president has shaken me by the hand and rubbed my upper arm. And Rahm looked at me and he said in his usual sardonic way, don't kid yourself, Mr. Ambassador. He was just wiping his hand. True story. In 2001, a little bit later, it fell to me to introduce Tony Blair to George W. Bush just after he'd been elected president the previous year, 2000. And this was an inaugural meeting. The two men had never met before. There was a good deal riding on this because As you know, the Blair-Clinton relationship had been very close, and the Blairistas were terribly worried about how they were going to get on with the Republican president. So President Bush was aware of this nervousness in London, said, let's have the meeting entirely informally over a nice weekend up at the presidential retreat at Camp David. It's about an hour by helicopter north of London, sorry, senior moment, north of Washington, and... Dear, oh dear. Is he making me laugh? Go stop. Not far from Watford. No, I don't mean that at all. About an hour north of Washington, D.C., up in the Catoctin Mountains of southern Maryland. And this provoked, instead of provoking pleasure in London, as it should have done, it provoked acute nervousness. And the phone rang, and a voice from Downing Street said to me, didn't want to know about what the agenda was going to be, didn't want to know about what world-shattering crises we were going to discuss together. He wanted to know, on behalf of the Prime Minister, what they should wear at Camp David. So I rang up the most powerful woman in the world, Condoleezza Rice, and said to her, Condi, there's London a bit worried about what they ought to wear at Camp David. And she said, huh, I don't know, but I will consult the President, the most powerful individual in the entire universe. And I'll call you back. And anyway, 2 hours later, she called me back. So I've spoken to the president, and he says he wants Mr. Blair to be comfortable in Camp David and the whole British team be comfortable. So he is going to wear, I'll get to geopolitics in a minute, he is going to wear beige chinos and a comfortable thing like a bomber jacket. He has a nice, has his favorite leather bomber jacket, and he'll probably wear a baseball cap as well. And he suggests that Tony wears something similar. No jeans. Jeans not allowed. But chinos, button-down blue shirt, nice blazer. Get them all from Brooks Brothers. I had to point out that there was no Brooks Brothers in London, but you know, there you go. There is now, of course. And I relay that message back to London. So, go out to the airport to meet the British team for the visit. And off the plane comes about 10 people in beige chinos, blue button-down shirts, blue blazers. You can see this on YouTube. Some of them wearing penny loafers. And they look like a cross between an Irish show band and a bunch of Mormon missionaries. Or maybe somebody from Heidi High, you know, holiday camp attendant. Except for the Prime Minister himself. And here I think I do need to have a kind of visual aid, because he insisted on wearing the tightest pair of blue corduroy trousers that you have ever seen. If any of you have got smartphones with you and you've got them on, because you're bored stiff of what I'm saying, just go into YouTube or Google and put in Camp David 2001, and you will see Tony Blair's skin-tight blue corduroy trousers. And this becomes relevant for the photo op, which was taken that afternoon, which had the two men walking through the woods of Camp David to show how much at ease they were and the special relationship was alive and well. And the President of the United States is incredibly relaxed. He's that kind of guy. And there is Tony Blair, and he's got a problem, because his trousers are so tight, he cannot get his hands in to show how relaxed he is, as relaxed as the President of the United States. So find that photograph and you'll see Bush, he always used to walk with his hands like this, and you'll see Tony going, anyway, it was a very, very successful meeting, and the President of the United States was so pleased with the meeting that he laid on a special movie that evening in the Camp David cinema. Wonderful place, full of massive sofas, barrels of popcorn, gigantic barrels of popcorn with a presidential seal around them. And the movie they showed was Meet the Parents, with Ben Stiller and Robert De Niro. And the high point, or low point, again, depending on your point of view, came when Ben Stiller character told the Robert De Niro character that his name was Gaylord Fokker, at which point the 43rd President of the United States collapsed, nay, howled with laughter, while the Blairs were sat there like, you know, your spinster aunt and your old uncle. Anyway, I tell you all this because those days were a high point in UK-US relations. They were more than that, actually. They were days of optimism throughout the Western world, even of hubris, with all that talk of the end of history and the final triumph of liberal capitalism. But, ladies and gentlemen, that was then, and this is now. And now we live in the age of the 4Ds. 4Ds. Danger, disorder, doubt, and Donald. We have to try to understand Donald Trump, first of all, in his international context, the thing that has framed his presidency. Because today we're witnessing what I call a great unraveling as the rules-based international order put in place after World War II, largely by the United States and the United Kingdom, is shaking on its foundations. And this has really been the case ever since the financial crisis in 2008. So look at the United Nations, the United Nations Security Council, effectively paralyzed on anything that matters for years and years. Or look at the World Trade Organization, on which we pin so many hopes if we crash out of the European Union. The World Trade Organization, which has not presided over a world trade deal since the 1990s. The International Monetary Fund, forever tainted by its unhappy association with the Greek debt crisis. The World Bank, which seems to have given up its primary vocation of alleviating poverty around the world. And then the European Union itself. And I know that on this subject, I am tippy-toeing on eggshells, but later on you've got massive experts on the European Union coming to talk about Brexit. So I'll just glide past this. But take the European Union itself, another organization which has a bit of a wobble going on. It is the highest form of international integration, but it is confronted with structural problems, I emphasize structural problems, which may in the end prove fatal. And I'll explain what I mean. Now, it's perfectly true that a cyclical economic recovery has kicked in, and the growth rate now of the EU27 is higher than that of the United Kingdom. And the rise of right-wing populist anti-EU, anti-immigrant parties has been checked, at least in France and in the Netherlands. But in Germany, the European Union's most powerful and most influential country, the anti-immigrant, anti-EU party, the AfD, Alternative für Deutschland, is now the third largest, I don't have to tell you, the third largest, with 94 seats in the German parliament. And underneath all of this is a Eurozone, the 19 out of the 28, I ought to say still. Under all this is a Eurozone with a fundamental structural flaw, because what is economically imperative for its survival, greater integration, has become, because of the rise of these right-wing parties, politically impossible. Or to put it another way, it is the place where President Macron of France's ambitions collide with Chancellor Merkel of Germany's buffers. And that's serious enough on its own for the EU. But the relentless pressure, it's gone out of the headlines a bit recently, but the relentless pressure of immigration from failed African and Asian states will not stop anytime soon, and nor will the tide of immigrants. And if the United Kingdom, the European Union's second largest economy, although the French always claim their economy is bigger than ours, who knows, they have their statistics, we have ours, the EU's second largest economy leaves the Union without a deal, which is possible, the budgetary cost to the Union will be highly destabilizing. All these factors would have been present whoever had won the US presidential election, Trump or Hillary last year. But the main point about Trump as a geopolitical force is that he is in himself, of his own volition, a deliberate unraveler of the established international order, as he is of the domestic American order. And this was the philosophy of his erstwhile advisor, Steve Bannon, who we are told, though he's now left the White House, is still closely advising Trump on political strategy. And if you look at, again, this is pretty well known, if you look at Trump's attitude to the world, I mean, we're now, today is the first anniversary of his election to the presidency. If we look at how his policies have emerged, such as they are over the last 12 months, we see a continuing hostility to free trade, a refusal, bizarre, to sign the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which would have been one of the main bulwarks of US influence against the expansion of the People's Republic of China. There's a massive question mark over the North American Free Trade Agreement, on which talks are taking place now. He has refused to join the Paris Climate Change Agreement. The United States, I think, is one of only three that have done so. And he constantly blows hot and cold over whether he likes NATO or doesn't like NATO. And for the first time, ladies and gentlemen, since the Second World War, the globe has lost its American anchor. And who is seeking to take advantage from this in a very, very explicit way? First of all, the People's Republic of China under President Xi, who more and more in China is called Emperor Xi, and Russia under President Putin, who more and more in Russia is called Tsar Vladimir. So, what about the special relationship between Britain and the United States? I hear you cry, or I don't hear you cry. Well, forget it. Forget the special relationship, or at least don't look at it through rose-tinted glasses, as the politicians of all parties invariably do. Let me be quite clear. I believe strongly that America is our closest partner and ally, our most important ally. Despite Trump, whether or not he existed, how could it be otherwise with such a vast concentration of British interests invested in the relationship? Economic, commercial, military, intelligence, cultural, and so on. But I don't believe in this thing called the special relationship. It had freshness, it had relevance when Winston Churchill first coined the phrase just after the Second World War, when we in the United States, among others, had defeated the Nazis. But again, that was then, and this is now. On this side of the Atlantic, the idea of a special relationship with the Americans has turned into a sentimentalized vision of UK-US relations, which generates unrealistic expectations and encourages British prime ministers to behave like poodles. It was a phrase that when I was ambassador in Washington 20 years ago, no, it was less than that, 14 years ago, I banned in the British embassy among the staff, so that they weren't led into self-deception and delusion. I once went to see the US Secretary of State, Colin Powell, during the George W. Bush administration. And it was on the eve of the first visit to Washington of our then, of the new British Foreign Secretary, Jack Straw, also a blessed memory. And Colin just wanted to talk to me about what he and Jack would talk about. And he also showed me his little introductory speech that he was going to make at the modest ceremony for the arrival of Jack Straw at the State Department. And I looked at the single sheet of paper, and on the top was scrawled in a black felt-tip pen, "Don't forget the special relationship." So I said to Colin, why do you need to have that written in there? And he said to me, "Well, we all know that you Brits will go apeshit if I don't mention the special relationship." And you know, something died inside me. I felt like I was the ambassador of Banana Republic. It was so demeaning that they should think we were so needy that phrase had to be there. Do you remember when Barack Obama came to came to London when Gordon Brown was Prime Minister. The look of blessed relief on Gordon's face when Barack Obama finally uttered the phrase, special relationship, others go spoon. You know, we don't need that kind of thing. We really don't. There have only been two British prime ministers, well, maybe three, two in particular since the Second World War, who have known how to use the relationship with the United States. One was Harold Macmillan, who extracted from JFK the Polaris seaborne nuclear missile, submarine-borne nuclear missile, on which the British deterrent today is based, and Margaret Thatcher in her relationship with Ronald Reagan. And I'm not making a party political point here, but the thing about the way that Thatcher handled the relationship is a model for every British Prime Minister. She acknowledged the closeness. She reveled in the closeness of the relationship, both professional and personal, with Reagan. But she was never afraid to tear him off a strip if she thought the United States was going down the wrong path. And a classic illustration of that was when the Americans got it into their head to invade the tiniest Caribbean island of Grenada, minute speck in the ocean, because they had a socialist prime minister who was friends with Fidel Castro. And the Americans saw that threatened their vital national interests, and the full might of the US Marine Corps was thrown onto the island of Grenada, which had probably in its armed forces, you know, a platoon plus a dog, and that was it. And after a hard-fought campaign, the Americans triumphed, and the news, of course, came to Margaret Thatcher. And she actually really did go apeshit, because what the Americans had forgotten completely, typically, was that Grenada was a member of the British Commonwealth, of the Commonwealth of Nations, and that the head of state of Grenada was Her Majesty the Queen. Therefore, the US President had unleashed the dogs of war on Queen Elizabeth II. So, Thatcher wasn't going to have any of that, and she telephoned. I heard this story from the then National Security Advisor, who was present in the room at the time. So she rang up Reagan in the Oval Office and said, "Do you know you have attacked?" And Reagan was, of course, mortified that he'd attacked the Queen. He loved the Queen, loved her. Just go riding together. I mean, he really did worship her. "You have attacked Her Majesty the Queen," said Margaret Thatcher. He banged on and on and on in this telephone conversation. And Reagan was sitting there in the Oval Office. He had his Secretary of State behind him, his National Security Advisor, his Chief of Staff, and they were all. They could hear the voice coming through the telephone, old-fashioned telephone in those days. So Reagan then suddenly flipped the switch so that her voice came into the Oval Office, ranting and blazing away at it. And he turned around to his advisors and he said, "Ain't she wonderful?" You know, that's the way you do it. It's a model to us all. Now, none of this is an argument against trying for a mutually beneficial trade agreement, free trade agreement with the United States once we drop out of the European Union. But you do have to be aware of the difficulties. The transmission belt from warm and woolly noises of encouragement coming out of the White House down to the hard cut and thrust of the negotiating table can be actually a very tenuous thing. Not least because most of the trade negotiators in the United States have been educated and trained as litigation lawyers. Can I go on for a bit longer? You would do it. Now, I'm trying to get through these remarks. I'm trying to get to the end. As I mentioned earlier, I've been sucked into the quicksands of Brexit. But I can't resist it just a teeny weeny bit. And I don't want to tread on the toes of your speakers that are coming. Now, let me just make a declaration of interest. I voted to remain, but now belong to the small and perfectly formed group of pragmateers, that is, remainers, who respect the referendum verdict and just want to get on with the negotiations as best as possible. And sometimes to cut through the crap, to get to the heart of things, it's useful to pray in a someone who, as the Texans say, don't have a dog in the fight. Now, if David Davis, for example, were to seek the advice, say, of an international relations expert from the planet Mars, the first thing our friendly extraterrestrial would say is that a deal between the United Kingdom and the EU27 post-Brexit is eminently feasible, since it is blindingly, stonkingly, gobsmackingly obvious that it is in the interests of both sides. Indeed, I doubt the Martian, when pressed, could conceive of two negotiating partners more closely aligned even before they start negotiating, given that for over 40 years they have, with very few exceptions, adopted identically the same regulations, the same directives, the same standards, and signed the same treaties. Which is why a UK-EU treaty should be a slim volume, a mere paperback, compared with a massive tome of the EU-Canada treaty, which Mr. Juncker so crassly took to his notorious dinner with the Prime Minister in number 10. In which case, the Martian would then ask himself, why are the Brexit talks so difficult? Well, money is the root of all evil, and that is the case in the Brexit talks. But there is more to it than that, which is much less discussed, and I would like to lay before you very briefly. There is also history, and there is also culture. The fact that, unlike any of the founder members of the original common market, Britain was neither invaded, occupied, or defeated in the Second World War, believe it or not, created a gulf between us, between them and us, which to this day has proved almost impossible to overcome. As I remember from my own days in Brussels, I was actually posted there, I have worked in the belly of the beast. Our EU partners aspire to the noble ambition of ever closer union, while we just wanted the meetings to run on time. Culture should never be underestimated. The EU's lead negotiator is Michel Barnier, a Frenchman. He could not be more French, if you see what I mean. The UK's lead negotiator is David Davis. He could not be more British, if you see what I mean. So at one level, the Brexit talks are just another episode in the centuries-long diplomatic rivalry between Britain and France. Our respective approaches to negotiation are quite different. We are steeped in common law, the French in the Code Napoleon. The French are inclined to say, yes, but. The British are inclined to say, no, because. We argue from the bottom up, they from the top down. I remember when I was posted in Brussels, being in a negotiation with the French on something really exciting, which was tariff quotas on imports of Romanian footwear. The kind of thing that really makes the blood run faster. And we've been arguing backwards and forwards for quite some time. And finally the Frenchman said to me, Monsieur Meyer, I agree that what you are proposing will work in practice. But what bothers my government is, will it work in theory? And there are one or two intellectuals here, I notice, Karen. We think they're devious. They think we are perfidious Albion. They throw Sir Henry Wotton at us, and we throw back at them the Comte de Talleyrand. For the historians again among you, I'm sure you remember that Talleyrand is the greatest foreign minister that France has ever had. And he was active in the late 18th century and in the first half of the 19th century. He served Napoleon, and he was considered so clever, so devious, that even Napoleon called him a silk-stockinged shit. For the linguists among you, that is de la merde en bas de soi. Talleyrand was also, although there are many people claiming this accolade, it was Talleyrand who, while at the Congress of Vienna in 1814 or 15, was sitting at the conference table, and for him, nothing could happen without it having some kind of Machiavellian twist to it. He was sitting at the conference table, and one of his aides appeared and whispered in his ear and said, "The Russian ambassador has died." And Talleyrand turned to him and said, "I wonder what he meant by that." It's like Churchill going to the rose-red city of Petra, in what is now Jordan, just before the Second World War. He was staying in the only inn that was there at the time, and he, like a lot of people, looked in the guest book, and he saw that a Frenchman had stayed at the inn, and an Englishman. And he looked at the inscriptions. This is Winston Churchill. And he saw the Frenchman had written, "From these noble ruins a still greater civilization will arise." That's what it said in French, of course. And he looked at what the Englishman had written. By contrast, "Damn good lunch." And there you have it. There you have it. That's why the Brexit talks are difficult. So I want to end on a happy note. You're looking impatient. I want to end on a happy note. Oh my God. The special relationship is alive and well and living in Texas. And I would remind you of the first woman governor of Texas. Her name was Muriel Ferguson. She was known as Ma Ferguson. She was in office in the 1920s. And she was taking part in a debate in the Texas legislature about whether Spanish should be given the same official status as English, and she was fiercely opposed. So she got up and she said, "If the King's English was good enough for Jesus Christ, it's good enough for the state of Texas." Thank you.